The 65-hectare construction site at Washwood Heath will eventually be home to the HS2 train maintenance depot and network integrated control centre, whilst around half of the site will be turned over to developers to construct logistics and distribution facilities, which will create an additional 1,000 jobs. In addition, construction teams working for Balfour Beatty Vinci JV have been toiling away below ground for 9 months to construct the tunnel portal that will receive the two tunnel boring machines which are constructing Bromford Tunnel. The tunnel portal is being constructed in a 22 metre deep retained cut, which will eventually be 750 metres long, and will bring trains to the surface from the tunnels, with the cutting itself running alongside the train maintenance depot. Construction of the retained cut is a mammoth undertaking, which is almost on a par with the construction of the enormous box, which will eventually be home to the HS2 platforms at Old Oak Common. The retained cut is in fact being constructed in a very similar way to the Old Oak Common box, which I explored last year. Before workers could begin excavation, a concrete diaphragm wall had to be constructed the full 750 metre length of the cut. The wall was constructed using a specialist piece of equipment fitted with a clamshell bucket which can excavate vertically. As the trenches for the wall sections were excavated, they were filled with a fluid known as bentonite. This fluid is lighter than concrete, but heavy enough to support the trench before the concrete is poured into it. Once excavated, workers lowered rebar cages into the trench, and then concrete was poured in. And as the concrete was poured, the bentonite was pumped out. The fluid was then processed so that it could be reused for the next trench to be excavated. The completed diaphragm wall, which is 1.2 metres thick, was excavated to a depth of 35 metres and fully encircles the cut. A number of piles were also installed before excavation begun, with the piling carried out at the surface. This means that the tops of the piles are having to be cut down as the cut is excavated. This process will leave behind piles which will be approximately 16 metres below the ground slab, which will be laid at the base of the cut. The rebar you can see sticking up here is the top of the piles, and will eventually be incorporated into the ground slab. The piles and 2 meter thick slab will work together to resist a phenomenon known as heave, which is the upward movement of the earth as it tries to fill the cutting from below. The diaphragm wall also needs to be supported to stop the walls from moving inwards. To that end, concrete beams known as props are being constructed. Some of the props are being constructed in situ, which is similar to how they were constructed at Old Oak Common. This method involves installing formwork and shuttering on top of a blinding layer, which is a temporary layer of concrete poured onto the ground. Rebar is then placed into the formwork, after which concrete is poured. Once the concrete is cured, the formwork is removed to leave behind a fully formed prop. Other 40-ton precast props are being constructed off-site and will be lifted into place as the cut is excavated. This is to allow more room for the excavators, as the cut slopes upwards to bring the tracks to the surface, which of course affects the headroom available. The precast props will be held in place with a large nut and bolt, but the props will actually be held permanently in place by friction, as the earth pushes against the diaphragm wall, and in turn the wall pushes against the props, thereby holding them in place. Given that the site for the cut is relatively constrained, there is a lot going on, with preparations underway at the eastern end for the pouring of the ground slab. Further west, workers are completing work on sumps, which will collect rainwater so that it can be pumped to the surface. And heading further west, workers are excavating spoil from within the cut. Initially, small excavators are used to remove spoil from around the props which were poured in situ. But as they work their way down, more headroom is provided so larger equipment can be used. Equipment such as this tracked loader, which can be seen in this shot. The spoil is moved by loaders and excavators to a spot so it can be lifted to the surface by specialist long reach excavators, which lifts the spoil and deposits it in waiting articulated dump trucks, otherwise known as ADTs. The ADTs then transport the material to other nearby parts of the HS2 route so it can be used as fill. with some of the material being used during the construction of Delta Junction. The eastern end of the cut will be where the two TBMs, which are constructing Bromford Tunnel, will arrive, with Mary Ann expected to arrive this year, whilst Elizabeth, which was launched in March, is expected to arrive in the summer of next year. Most of the parts of Elizabeth were in fact first used to construct Long Itchington Tunnel and completed both drives before being dismantled and transported to Washwood Heath. Bromford Tunnel will have a diameter of just over 8 metres, whereas Long Itchington Tunnel, through which trains will be travelling faster, has a diameter of 10 metres. Therefore, a new tunnel shield and outer cutter head was installed before Elizabeth could start excavating Bromford Tunnel. Bromford Tunnel will be a twin bore tunnel and will be 5.6 kilometres long, with the eastern portal located immediately after Delta Junction in Water Orton. I'll be releasing a video about Delta Junction soon, so be sure to subscribe and hit the notification bell so you don't miss that video. And just before I sign off, I'd like to thank HS2 Limited and BBV for the tour of the cut. It was a privilege to be able to explore the cut and find out how it was constructed.